Well, the last speaker is myself. I must say I'm visibly impressed by how disciplined all the speakers have been in the use of time. It remains to be seen whether I will be similarly disciplined. The English poet T.S. Eliot wrote in a work called The Four Quartets, "History can be freedom, history can be servitude, slavery." Now, I want to suggest, because the theme of this session is history, that history has been largely servitude. And I want to suggest towards the very end of my closing remarks how we may, in some ways, rethink the idea of history. If you look at the British conquest of India, the French conquest of Algeria and Indochina, the Dutch conquest of Indonesia, and so on, it is very clear that in the last analysis, these were conquests of knowledge. The colonizer came, yes, exercised military dominance, in some cases had superior technology, not always, certainly had a superior administrative and bureaucratic system. But nonetheless, I think it is fundamentally clear when one looks at the study of colonialism in a concerted way, that long after the colonizer had left the shores of these countries, the colonized continued to remain colonized. And that is our fundamental condition today. And I want to suggest to you that one of the principal ways through which colonization took place within the domain of knowledge, so in other words, I'm arguing that imperialism is not simply to be understood through economic, military, administrative categories, it's to be understood as a project of knowledge, which means that you take the knowledge system of those who have been colonized and you supplant it, replace it with your own knowledge system. And knowledge systems have politics. So my fundamental submission here to you is that history was one of the principal elements of the knowledge system of the colonizer, and this is what I want to do, is to look at the place of history within the colonization of knowledge systems. Now, of course, history has many different meanings. And the sense in which I'm going to be using it here is principally history as a discipline of thought, as a mode of inquiry. But of course, history also has the meaning of what happened in the past. So for example, in the English expression, if I may use this one, George Bush is history, which means that he belongs to the past. Forget about it, right? He is history. He is gone. And that's, of course, the other sense in which we use history. History is something that happened in the past. I think that one of the unfortunate things that happens is that history and the past are taken to be, in fact, coterminous. They're taken to be words that are synonyms, which, in fact, is not the case at all, right? It's something, I think, that we would have to think about a great deal more, and I'm going to try to suggest why that's the case. Now, there are three fundamental things that I want to really talk about in relation to the idea of history. One is the idea of the nation state. Secondly, the idea of development. And thirdly, the idea of the textbook. Because I want to suggest that the idea of history has an inextricable relationship with these three dominant ideas. The rise of history and the rise of the nation state took place simultaneously. And I think it's worthwhile remembering always that Iran, India, China, to name just three cases, were civilizations long before they became nation states. And civilizations are in principle much richer entities than the nation state. In fact, in my view, the nation state is probably the most insidious form of community ever invented in human history. Okay? But it's certainly very clear, if you look at historiography, that is the writing of history and when the idea of history became dominant, and yes, I'm aware of the fact that the ancient Greeks and the Chinese, among others, of course, had a sense of history. You know, if you go to Greece, you find that one of the major figures in the ancient past, of course, is Thucydides, right? Who's writing in the 5th century BC, and the Chinese have always had a sense of history. But I'm trying to suggest to you that the universalization of history as a discipline has a relationship with the rise of the nation state, and the nation state system, of course, comes into existence in the 17th century with the Treaty of Westphalia in the 1640s, right? Now, the nation state is, in other words, a relatively recent entity in history. And the nation state is something that is achieved only through violence. I mean, a spectacular example of that is France, where if you look at the history of France, as late as 1830, many of you will be surprised to hear, as late as 1840, the vast majority of people who actually lived in what is today called France were not speakers of French. They were not speakers of French. Now, how these people were turned into Frenchmen has to do with the use of violence. Because what a nation state does is it produces a certain homogeneous subject. Okay, a certain homogeneous subject who then has to pay loyalty to the nation state. One of the ways you pay loyalty to the nation state is through the national flag, the national anthem, and of course I'm going to argue eventually the textbook as well. Right? So I'm trying to suggest to you that if the nation state is an extraordinarily impoverished idea, because it is a fundamentally coercive idea to try to fit people into a certain human community, then we have to understand the oppressive role of history in the creation of the nation state. And it is no accident that when a nation state comes into being, the very first thing that a nation state does, it produces an authorized history of itself. An authorized history of itself, right? So this is the first fundamental argument, that there is an inextricable relationship between the idea of history and the nation state. Secondly, I want to look at the idea of development, which again has an inextricable relationship with the idea of history. What exactly is development? Before the 1940s, the word was seldom ever used in the English language. We used to speak of something called social change, right? And then in the post-World War II period, eventually development became the dominant ideology. In fact, so dominant that it was virtually impossible to dissent from the idea of development, because if you spoke to somebody and offered a critique of development, the obvious rejoinder would be, well, why is it that you do not want us to develop? Okay, right? But then we also have to ask, of course, what exactly is development, and why is it that genocide has largely taken place, okay, in the last four or five decades through the mode of development? What does development mean? For example, in the Indian context, and this context can be replicated in China, where if you've seen what has happened to the rural countryside, I mean, the rural countryside in China has been virtually eviscerated, wiped out, okay? Now, in India, we know that approximately 70 to 80 million people have been displaced through projects of development. And the people who are displaced through projects of development are not the elites. They're not middle-class populations of the great metros. These are people who live at the margins. These are people who are adivasis or tribals or lower caste people, right? These are people who live at the margins, and development is a very slow form of genocide. And one of the most insidious things about development, of course, I'm trying to suggest to you, is that it makes it impossible to dissent from the idea. I mean, this is the nature of totalizing systems of knowledge, is that they don't even allow you any provision for dissent. All right? And I'm suggesting to you that if you look at development, there is a fundamental relationship with temporality, time, which of course is a principal unit through which you understand history. And what do I mean by that? Let me put it to you in very, very simple and plain language. There is something called the developed world, and there is something called the underdeveloped world. What the underdeveloped world has been told is that their task is to catch up with the developed world. Okay? In other words, the underdeveloped world's present is the past of the developed world, because they've already had that history. We want to catch up with that history. But it doesn't stop there, because the underdeveloped person, his or her future is in fact the present of the person who's already developed. What development does, in other words, is completely hijacks both the present and the future of those who are described as underdeveloped, right? So I'm suggesting here that development is not, in fact, a spatial category. When we think of development, I mean, most of the textbooks on development will describe something called the underdeveloped world and say, well, that's the South, okay? So that includes India, Pakistan, includes portions of Africa, so forth and so on. right? And then we know there's something called the developed world, which means obviously the West, the industrial North, Japan, Australia, so forth and so on, right? I'm suggesting to you that in fact, development, what is crucial to development is the notion of temporality, and what development does, the ideology of development does, is it condemns the underdeveloped to live not their history, but someone else's history, right? That's essentially what it does. Thirdly, I want to speak about history and the textbook. Now, when the nation state comes into being, as I mentioned, the first project of the nation state is to produce an authorized history of itself. This authorized history is then replicated in something known as the textbook. And I've always found it rather remarkable that there have been countries, and I can think of three immediately, and in these three cases, I know the details in substantial extent. So I'm going to mention these three countries: United States, China, and India. Three countries where you have had, in the course of the last 10 or 15 years, what are called textbook controversies. Okay, so these are controversies over what should be the content of the textbook. What is truly remarkable, of course, is that nobody has dissented within this argument from the idea of the textbook itself. Right? And the textbook is, in fact, a relatively recent invention, once again, of human history. What does a textbook do? It doesn't simply synthesize a body of knowledge. It homogenizes that body of knowledge. It homogenizes it. So that if you have a notion of science, what the textbook of science will try to do is, it will try to eliminate or diminish the idea of plurality of sciences, the idea of plurality of medicinal systems, right? I mean, so if you look at a textbook of medicine that is used in a medical school, almost anywhere in the world, you'll find that this textbook of medicine is based on a notion of medicine which is allopathic. It's based on the idea of vivisection or division, right? And what I'm suggesting here is that we have to see how the textbook became such a prominent feature of the modern world, right? Now, moving very quickly towards my concluding remarks, I mean, Raju had spoken about solutions. I want to suggest a few other ways in which we might want to think about this. Number one, I want to suggest that history is not simply about remembering. I think that this is the dominant sense in which people want to think about history. There isn't a single ethnic, racial, linguistic, social group in the world that does not want its history, okay? But I think what is crucial to history is not only remembering, but also forgetting, oblivion, right? History cannot be anything other than servitude unless it becomes a dialectic of remembering and forgetting. The second point that I would like to put for your consideration is that one of the most tragic consequences of colonialism all over the world is that colonialism obscured, okay, made irrelevant, if we want to put it in different language, the kinds of histories that had existed long before. I mean, many people sitting in China or Iran or India or Africa think that it is their encounter with the West that brought them into the modern world. That this was the first real multicultural encounter that they had with the wider world. Of course, that's far from being the truth, because if you look, for example, at the Indian Ocean world from the 10th to the 15th century, it was an extraordinarily rich world where people from India, China, Southeast Asia, the East Coast of Africa, the Gulf, interacted with each other over a period of 6 or 7 centuries. In other words, what I'm trying to say here is that long before Iran or India or China or Japan even encountered the West, they had encountered each other in conditions that were far more hospitable, in conditions that were not necessarily as oppressive as they have been under colonialism. And if I had to put it in the simplest language, I think that one of the things that we have to think about is forgetting the West altogether. We need to have more interaction and dialogue with each other rather than with bringing the West into all of these particular dialogues. Thank you.